this Sunday. Side by side at the microphone, from the green light to the speed trap, Chris Switzer and Ray Garino calls them as they sees them, and you better believe them. Here! Relevant news, biased opinions, and outright bullshit regarding every aspect of automotive culture. Gas, but mechanical trickery never before revealed over FCC-regulated airwaves. Thrilled to the explosive tension as Chris and Ray cuss each other down the track and barrel roll across the finish line, laughing at certain disaster as they shake hands with the devil! All that and much more this Sunday at high noon on the MotorMouth Radio Hour. Call in and speak live with the Wizards of Speed and live feed, Chris Switzer and Ray Garino. Bring the whole family. Kids under 12 get in free. Every Sunday at noon on WHPC. Take the Long Island Expressway to the Meadowbrook Parkway and look for the sign saying no parking on the expressway and no express service on the parkway. Go ride on Highway 24 to Garden City. $2 all-day parking includes pit pass. Sunday!
And that's right. We want to feel that you're here whenever we call on MotorMouth Radio, Long Island's only automotive talk show, with your hosts, Ray Guarino and Chris Switzer. How you doing, Chris, over there in the other regions?
Yes, here in the Constitution State, things are blooming, I guess you could say. Things are flowering and blooming. And you know, we have something here called No Mo May. Did you ever hear of that?
No Mo May?
No Mo May, yes. You know what No Mo May here is in the Constitution, in the state of the Constitution? You know what that is?
No.
There are actually houses that do not mow their lawns in the month of May to help the bees, believe it or not.
I heard about that somewhere. I think I read it. It was in a paper, yeah. And so you're kind of lush and back to nature. As it were.
I'm very floral. It is very florally and fauna-y here.
It's kind of like a 70s kind of a 70s movie.
Horror movie.
Where there's lots of foliage and stuff.
Yes.
Okay.
So a lot of Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom.
Yes.
No, I actually do not partake in No Mow May because I mow my lawn.
Right.
Because I like to talk to my neighbors every once in a while. Yeah. I don't like them pointing at me and holding their nose. So it's funny in the process. I had to start up my lawnmower for the first time all year. I mean, the last time I think I used it was sometime in October, November. So, of course, I rolled this old grinder out. And I did not, I have to tell you, I did absolutely nothing to it. In 4 months, I just let it sit there. And this is how stagnant this thing was. I go to pull the cord to go to start it, and the cord doesn't snap back.
It doesn't recoil back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it doesn't recoil. It slowly rolls back.
Yeah, so you're taking the advice of a great wealth of knowledge automotive talk show in your dealings. Very good.
Totally. Nice. So, of course, what do you think I do? I pull it again.
Right.
And, of course, does nothing. So a couple of times, and then finally it kicked up, fired up. I was like, woo!
Okay.
Lucky little bugger I am.
Yes.
Yeah, I get to mow my lawn. And, of course, the wheels are wobbling on it. It's an embarrassment.
Wow.
It is a complete embarrassment for a lawnmower. You really would think I am just so a terrible maintainer of... If you saw this lawnmower, this old Briggs & Stratton from the early 80s that has like stickers all over it from some other family's kids.
I got a mower for you if you want. I've been keeping it in my shed, but I have a gardener, so I'm not. It's really taking up space, and I hate to just get rid of it because I really will have to talk about this. Yeah.
No, that'd be great. That'd be three. Well, you know the story. I please stop me if I told you this, but I had this lawnmower. I bought this particular one with the wobbly wheels and everything from an estate sale up the road when we first got the house. I didn't get a new lawnmower. I bought this old thing. And of course, it had a little carburetor trouble and I was messing with it. And I had happened at this time go and have some dinner with some friends in the city. And I was talking about the carburetor trouble I was having because my wife wanted to mow the lawn. Mm-hmm. And my buddy Corey leans over to me and says, "You mean your wife is waiting for you to fix the carburetor on this old lawnmower so she can mow the lawn, right?" I said, "Yeah."
Yeah.
He looked me dead in the face and went, "Buy her a new lawnmower."
Or at least a new carburetor.
So I went out, bought a brand new lawnmower.
Right.
For my wife.
Well, I'll tell you what. We got a flashy button. Let's go to the phones and go to the fun and say hi. You're on with the Motormouths.
Good morning. Good afternoon. This is John from Freeport. How is everyone?
Hey, John, how are you? Haven't talked to you in a while.
John. Yeah.
I'm very good. I was going to call and get some advice on getting my lawnmower to start up. I didn't do anything to my lawnmower either, and I also sort of left it uncovered in the backyard.
Uh-oh.
So the spark plug contact looks good. It's all silvery and new. Everything looks fine. I wasn't able to, you know, pull the ripcord and see if a spark was coming out at the same time, you know, because it's way too far away. But I'm assuming a spark's coming out. So what would be, well, that's the reason I was calling in the first place. The next thing is to try and get a free lawnmower, you know.
Right.
Someone in there has a lawn. So, but what would be the next thing that I check on my lawnmower?
Well, it's the same thing as everything else. It's always fuel and spark. You know, I mean, fuel and, yeah, it's gas and ignition is really, you know, and compression, the only things, and air. So take the air cleaner out, make sure that it's not filled with, you know, schmutz and mud and dirt and all sorts of other, you know, Freeport ground up stuff. I would take the spark plug out, take a look at it, make sure it's not all carboned up and see if there's, you know, that it looks okay. You can clean it, you can regap
it. It looks beautiful. I was going to scratch it a little bit, but yeah, I'm sure they're both really shiny. The gasoline that was in it, maybe I should have poured it out on the ground or because I put some new 92 high ethanol, you know, stuff in it, but maybe it was already. The question is, does gasoline get old over the winter?
Yes, it gets old.
It does.
A lot faster than it used to. The biggest problem is going to be what fuel was sitting in that carburetor bowl over the winter. And ethanol has a tendency over time, especially when exposed to air in a non-vented system, turns to gel, like a jelly. And if it doesn't run, the first thing to look at is that carburetor. Very, very common. And it's the number one. You know, it's the number one repair on any small engine is the carburetor. It's
do they get flooded when I'm pressing that thumb thing?
You have a primer on?
Yeah, that does it. Well, what that does is that manually induces fuel into the intake, like as if, right, if you had sprayed like starter fluid down, you know, down in a car. So that just it's a they call it a primer bulb, and that again just primes the system so that spark can light off something, you know. And they go bad too. Right. I mean, there's a lot of little maladies that can happen, but you have to just look at it systematically, one by one.
All right, I will tackle those problems now. Does someone have a $30 lawnmower they're trying to move along in Valley Stream?
Ah, yeah, there may be, and you know, now there's other stuff coming in. You should, you know what, get in touch with us. Send us an email, motormouthradio@ncc.edu, and we'll keep you in the loop on that.
Yeah, John, I have one with the wobbly wheel option. You're going to love it.
Right, right.
I'll muscle through it. I'm on the verge of getting a ticket, so I could use it.
All right.
Good show. Oh, it's my birthday today. Wish me a happy birthday.
Oh, happy birthday, John.
Hey, happy birthday.
Thanks, guys. Great show.
All right, thanks.
Appreciate it.
So long.
Thanks, John. Bye-bye.
All right.
516-572-7440. Oh, I forgot to mention that the lawnmower, the wobbly wheel lawnmower, has also two huge cracks in the body of it just past where the propeller is, where the blades are.
Yeah.
Because I have some shallow roots in the backyard, and I'll bump this thing along across the shallow roots.
Yeah.
It's like a 4x4. It's like an off-roader.
Yep. So you need a blade.
I need a blade. I need a body.
Right.
I have to weld both sides of it.
Okay.
I'm looking for excuses not to weld. That's too close to the car. That's too close to the house.
All right. So let me tell you something. You're going to love this. Yeah. This is our main topic of the show today.
Oh, you mean we're talking about cars?
Yeah. Well, we will be in a minute if you let me.
This is the most inappropriate and uncalled for automotive talk show. I'm sorry.
Well, the question I pose today is the MotorMouth Radio jinx from a couple weeks ago contagious?
Ooh.
Now, that video that we put up got a lot of views. That was one of the highest views we got about the MotorMouth Radio jinx. And I was talking about light bulbs. It was a light bulb jinx because I found, you know, after the call I had problems and problems, and I had a bulb out right after that.
Wow. That's a heavyweight question.
So let me, I'm not done.
Ooh.
I mean,
okay.
That's just the opening statement.
You got the gears turning.
Is the jinx contagious? And I will tell you why I ask that. Because in the last 2 days, I have had to visit two people who are two friends of the show. They're actually like family to the show. These are close friends of the show.
Okay.
And it involves two cars, one from each of them. They're both GMs from the 68 to 72 year range, so they're the same vintage.
Got it.
And they both run like crap after having a previous work done.
And after you rebuilt the carburetor for both.
No, I was called in to try and find out why they're running like crap and fix them, and neither one right now is fixed.
Here's a dumb question. Is it the same ailment, or do you think it's a similar ailment that's plaguing both of them?
Well, one car ran beautifully, and I think there was a little bit of the owner wanted to change the carburetor, had a carburetor rebuilt from a reputable place, a place that he used previously, who did a stellar job. I know, because I installed that carburetor on his other car, so I know that this guy he used is top shelf.
Got it.
Then he had the car, he had a brake conversion done, where it's a four-wheel drum car, and he had just power brakes installed, power master cylinder and booster installed.
Okay.
And I guess that carburetor was installed. Now the car doesn't want to run right. You start it up, it doesn't want to idle. You get it to like 1,500 RPM, and then it actually had a muffler explosion that blew the muffler apart.
What?
Yeah, and now it just doesn't want to run right. And
well, you just described two components that involve vacuum,
mm-hmm.
which I'm thinking that's what ties those together.
Good,
right?
Yeah, that's a good thought. And I'll tell you what I did on Friday when I looked at that car. I put a tac mm-hmm. dwell meter on it because it has points. I thought maybe the points were closed. You know, no, I had a 30 degree dwell, which is right because 28 to 32 is our range. I put a vacuum gauge on a manifold source, and I had good steady vacuum. So anything I was thinking that might have been a valve issue, then you'd usually see a bouncy needle. So
yes.
But I couldn't keep the car running at a reliable rate to go any further. So
it's funny because it blew up the exhaust. I'm just formulating here. So it's obviously, or not obviously, but my theory is that it's running rich.
Well, I had a car that did that. My Buick Riviera did that many years ago. I just had a full exhaust system put on a car, dual exhaust,
right.
And literally just drove home and everything was driving for the no issues at all. I pulled onto my block and bob, boom, and like this, like a shotgun blast. And that's how they described this muffler explosion. It was loud. Really? One of the guys was deaf for 2 hours. And what it is, you know, this is what guys used to do in the 50s. They would, you know, rev up the car, rev up the flathead, and pull the manual choke to richen the mixture and flood that system with fuel. And then what they would do is, you know, get the thing to backfire and wrap. Or they would a step further, put a spark plug in the tailpipe that they would light off, and then they'd have, you know,
flame.
They'd have a flamethrower.
Sure, sure.
So that's what the muffler explosion is. It's fuel, raw fuel in the system that does light off, and then that pulse goes down the pipe and, you know, I guess it gets trapped in the muffler, has nowhere to go, so it blows up.
Right.
So that was one issue that now we have to go further with. I'm looking for another carburetor to test is what I'm looking for. The second car that I looked at yesterday, also a GM of that vintage, the owner, you know, had been driving this car. He just changed the carburetor, went from a Holley to an Edelbrock, and he changed the fuel pump. A little while ago, and now that car had a noise it was described to me like a pre-ignition noise, like a pinging you know, when the timing is way too advanced or...
Marbles in the crankcase sort of sound.
And what we actually used was a borescope to look down the spark plug holes and Ooh. Saw on cylinder number 4 a clean piston top, very clean, which is a little odd. And what looked like an arch-shaped, could be a crack in the piston, we can't say for sure, but the thing we did see on the other side of the piston looked like a scratch mark, like someone went in there with a screwdriver and scratch, like a clean, it's as clear as day on the camera. You couldn't miss this thing as being like, so I said, well, maybe something fell into the, you know, fell through a valve, and, you know, things will get, like a nut may get trapped in there and lodge in the piston, but other things can fall in and then like just get bashed up and then send out the exhaust valve, you know?
Right, but if it's scratched up, that's the theory, if something like that happened, not only is the piston scratched up, but I'm sure the cylinder walls or the bottom of the head are also scratched as well.
Okay, good thought. And to that, we looked with the borescope, we could see the valves. They look fine, no cracks, no chips, no marks on the valves at all. And the cylinder has a beautiful crosshatch in it. This motor doesn't have a lot of miles on it. The cylinder looks fine. It's just on the top of that one piston, and there's nothing in there. Whatever was in there is gone. So those are the two issues I looked at in the past 2 days from two people with two cars who are very close friends of this show who have two mysterious ailments, and I have to wonder, is the MotorMouth Radio Jinx contagious? Because if it is, dun, dun, dun. We're losing listeners and friends real fast.
We lose listeners. It's
We don't have to have a jinx.
Just one crummy automotive talk show. We can lose a bunch of listeners.
So there's that. So that was what was going on. And you know, I'm going to keep in touch, obviously, with both of them. I'll probably be having my hands on both of those cars again as we diagnose further.
Well, just to backtrack a second and to step away from the problem, talking about the curse, we know, and you and I have grown up with this, that starting out in the early days, you could never say that your car was running well. You couldn't do that. You could never make that boast. No red-blooded man and no gearhead himself will say, or woman, will say, my car is running fantastic. I don't have to touch it any longer. Have you ever heard anyone say that with any sort of legitimacy and their car ran fine after that? No. The car usually completely grenaded like moments after they made that statement. I actually said that one time. I says, my car is running so well. I tested the statement and literally as I finished making the statement, the lower hose on the radiator went splash. There was coolant everywhere. And I could remember exactly where I was and what year it was.
Right.
I'm going back mid-80s. So this has been, this is something that we've grown up with. You never say your car is running well, first of all. And second of all, and this is something that I have not mentioned in a while, and I think I probably mentioned it early on in our programming with my longtime radio colleague, but I've always talked about a little air freshener that nobody should put in their vehicle.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going back, 30 years, at least 30, maybe, almost 40 years. There is something you do not put in your car, and if it's in your car now, you take it out. You remember the black square Playboy Bunny air freshener?
Yes, I do.
Remember everybody had one?
Not everybody, but I do remember, yeah.
Yeah, everybody I knew had one.
Right, well, and from a Brooklyn, what do you expect?
And everybody I knew had one had problems with their car until they took it out.
Aha, uh-huh. Okay.
I'm serious.
I never had that curse because I'm a green Christmas tree guy.
I am serious. I can give you story upon story, but we only have an hour.
Right.
I can give you many, multiple stories of individuals that had those air fresheners, those Playboy Bunny air fresheners in their car, and had trouble with their car until they got that thing out of there, and then their car was okay.
So that was the MotorMouth Radio Jinx before the Jinx existed.
Exactly. Yeah. I'm taking you way back.
Okay.
The last holdout was my buddy Mikey, who said, no, you're full of beans. It's not the air freshener. And he kept one proudly hanging off the glove box door handle in his car until we were out one day and his car got creamed by some drunk and kept going. It was a hit and run. And his car was the only car that got damaged. Really bad. Wow. And we went trying to chase after the guy who hit him. We couldn't catch him. Uh-huh. But when we came back, the Playboy Bunny air freshener was out in the middle of the street. Yeah, rain. Yeah. He learned his lesson. So it's this jinx that we speak of, not only comes and goes, but it's like a virus. It morphs.
Right. Oh, yeah. Yeah. It'll change. Well, this started with bulbs. This started with light bulbs. So if you have, or you think you may have, the MotorMouth Radio jinx or a form of it, give us a call at 516-572-7440. Or you can tell us about it on social media. We're, of course, on the web and Twitter and Facebook at MotorMouth Radio and on Instagram at real_MotorMouthRadio. And, yeah, we'd love to hear about it. So
yes, and we can even go back to the recent past with one of our callers. His name was Bill, right? And Bill called us up.
Oh, sure.
And basically revived this.
Well, he's the one who really kind of started it with his brake lines.
Yeah, well, we kind of knew of our superstitions. We never actually affixed a name to it. He did.
That was Bill from Freeport, yeah.
Yes, he affixed the name MotorMouth Radio Jinx to it because I think every time he spoke.
I think he called it the MotorMouth Radio Curse.
Oh, he did call it?
I think it was the Curse.
We got to listen to the promos.
I believe same thing. You know, Curse, Jinx, we're going to use Jinx. The same.
One or the other, but he had some problems. He had called us about some brake problems. The next thing you know, he had like 100 more brake problems.
But you know, like in that world, like again, that same Riviera that I had, I had popped the brake line one day going to work, you know, and then drove home and repaired the section. And then another piece, it just kept popping down the road. So that's what happens with those things. If you don't change the whole line, you're kind of asking for trouble. So
you totally. No, you know. You're absolutely right.
But whatever.
No, I agree. But yeah, that's one of those. It's something that I guess it has now gone from these similar stories of superstitious behavior, and now it's all compiling into this one umbrella of don't say anything, don't do anything, just leave it alone, everything's fine.
Exactly.
Right. If you have a car question, don't call us.
Well, I want to tell you what's
it
not
may get worse.
I want to tell you what's not superstition, what is real and what is good and something you might want to do today. I have a list out of the paper today. There's like a list of car shows going on today.
Oh, I'm sure. And I mean, a great day too.
I mean, I will tell you there are, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 of them. But the one I want to talk about and encourage people to visit is our good friends from the Long Island and New York City Oldsmobile Club. And they're at Fortown Fireman's Training Center in Merrick on Merrick Road today.
Our old stomping grounds.
It's the 45th annual 2022 Spring Dust Off. And that it benefits the John Thiessen Children's Foundation. That's going on from 9 to 3 today. And, you know, spectators are 5, under 12 is free, and you should go down and check that out. That's where I had entered a car in that show many years ago, and I saw the way they did the judging, and that's where I adopted my judging format that went forward from there that I've used and taught to people. And I've taught, now, of course, Bob Jones is one of the executives of the club. And we're very good friends. And I've told him that. I said, you know, I kind of stole your thing and just kind of. He goes, you know what? That's great because it's a great format. And he was happy to see that it lived on with other clubs. And I said, yeah, it was just such a great way of judging, which takes the pressure off of people. One day we'll talk about it. We've talked about it in detail in the past. We don't have to go into it now, but we'll get into it another time.
No, but just to highlight parts of it, I think that you were able to effectively sum up a vehicle in a very efficient way.
Yeah.
And that your technique, I think basically you had one group working on exteriors and one group working on interiors and one group working on like undersides and things like that, which I thought was stellar.
As a team approach. So you had maybe four people who went around to every car and each person did one or two sections of that sheet for every single car, so you'd have repetition. And then, you know, then when you do your totals, you're not all over the place, and it works great. So
yeah, what's nice is that you don't have one person looking at one car completely.
Right. Yeah, it gets a little boring. Yeah, you got
three people looking at the same car, and then you can tally it up if they all of their opinions all are positive or negative.
Yeah.
I think it's a more accurate judging of a vehicle. Yeah.
So what else is accurate that we do every week is the honor group of the hour. And I tell you, Art, we have a topic. I do have another topic for the second half of the show.
Ooh, that's good.
Which plays into the honor group of the hour because another very good close friend of the show whose family texted me this morning and told me that he fell into your honor group from last week perfectly. And he gave me some examples. So we're going to make that our show topic for the second half.
Oh, wow.
So do you have something new and exciting that people may want to remember, aside from the other stuff you usually tell everybody?
Of course I do. Is this MotorMouth Radio? Is this a mess of an automotive talk show? You bet. We have the highlight of the bottom of the hour, the MotorMouth Radio Honor Group of the Hour. And if you have a fondness for vehicles that have no options, do you like two-door post cars with no power steering or power brakes or that dreaded air conditioning that because it adds weight or robs power? Ugh. Do you like vehicles with radio delete plates on the dashboard or no hole on the fender for an antenna? How about a full metal dashboard over that annoying padded stuff to protect your face? That stuff's no good. Do you dig rubber floor mats, Econoline bucket seats bolted directly to the floor, minimal side trim, and dog dish hubcaps? Well, if you think that less is more, and it's appealing in your vehicle, in your vehicle preferences, then you're part of the MotorMouth Radio Honor Group of the Hour.
Yeah, those cars are called strippers. That's what we call them, the strippers, exactly.
Da, 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 da,
yeah, I know. So while you're driving in your stripper, listening to the strip music, you could also tune into the Radio Rumble Saturdays at noon on this fine station, and you'll hear a vast knowledge of pop culture and a unique sense of humor by host Justin Greenberg, who brings you a show unlike any other. He plays everything from classic rock hits from the 50s all the way up to today's superstars, and that's an intriguing show. But for now, our second song, I teased you with this earlier. This is one of those ones I had to go out far and wide to find because I didn't have it. And if you've ever seen the video, it's an early MTV video that was that animatronic kind of thing because it was before it was an early video, so they didn't have all the skills they had today. But the song always, it was just one of those songs kind of like, you know, when I played the Dovells, Can't Sit Down, that always spoke to me and grabbed me since I'm a kid. This one always kind of spoke to me too since it came out. It has an actual a cameo from a very famous DJ in it, which we probably won't hear in this mix, but
clap for the Wolfman.
That's a great, yeah, well,
money for nothing.
You're closer than you think, but so let's tune it up. Same group that played the first song, which I know you didn't know because that was kind of like a B-side cut.
I didn't know it, yeah.
I know. Well, this is the band. This is the song. Listen along, and we'll play a couple clips, and we'll be back in a minute or two with more MotorMouth Radio. Chris Switzer, Ray Guarino, keep it where you got it on 90.3 WHPC. Here we go.
A long distance directory assistance, every quote 212. Say hey.
This show on 90.3 WHPC is brought to you by CarStar Celebrity Chase Collision, with two locations in Limbrook and Oceanside, who remind you that New York State law says you always have the right to choose which shop will fix your car. CarStar Celebrity Chase Collision offers a full range of services, 24-hour towing between Montauk and Manhattan, shuttle service, and they can help you with a rental car arrangement if needed. All repairs include the CarStar Lifetime Nationwide Warranty, ensuring that the experts at Celebrity Chase Collision are always on your side.
Y si hablamos español.
More information is available by calling 516-593-0920 or visiting online at celebritychasecollision.com.
You're listening to the Motor Mouth.
Hello, gentlemen.
Excellent.
You guys call yourself hot rods. Come on, man. I was waiting for you to learn how to trim my bonsai plant.
Motor Mouth.
Love the show and keep them coming.
You have to excuse me. I was just outside messing around with the car.
I'm reluctant to say I'm anything like you guys.
Motor Mouth.
But I am exactly like you guys. I try and keep every old thing going. Good show as usual.
Motor Mouth.
You guys are trouble. I know you guys have your finger on the pulse of stuff.
Our trained staff of two will help.
Come on and ask and answer some car questions. I'm a fountain of useless knowledge.
Quite frankly, there are better things to do with your time.
Instructions are just another man's opinion, Ray.
Yeah, I talk to you guys when I need you. I appreciate you. I listen to you.
Yeah, I want to know what the is wrong with my car.
I'll be glad to answer any questions for you. I can. You're different because you glow in the dark, so it's all good.
Rob, can I ask you a question?
Sure, ask anything you want.
Motor Mouth!
Have you heard from Ray or Chris saying that this was going to be the best show ever in the history
of mankind?
No, you see,
it's funny because Ray will come in and say, well, Rob, this is going to be the greatest show
we've
ever done.
It's not Sunday morning until I'm sure.
And sometimes Chris...
Motor Mouth Radio is going to be the best show that was ever done.
And then Chris will sometimes joke that it's going to be the worst show they've ever done.
There are answers, sometimes correct ones, and we may have them.
Motor Mouth Radio, 90.3 FM, WHPC.
Motor Mouth!
Hey you, get over here. Every Sunday, 12 to 1, you are going to tune in to hear the Motor Mouths, my friends Ray Guarino and Chris Switzer. 90.3 FM, WHPC. You might learn something.
How's that for a blast from the past, huh?
Right, Loaf?
Do you remember the video?
No.
It was a telephone that assembled itself in like an animatronic way. It was very early, like claymation almost.
Wow.
And yeah, it was really kind of clunky, but it was the song. And I tell you, and of course, Wolfman Jack is in that song.
Wolfman Jack is in that song. Yeah, definitely. I totally forgot that he was in that song. You're right. You're right.
Sugarloaf.
Sugarloaf, yes.
And I tell you, besides Green Eyed Lady and that song, there was nothing else on here that I knew, which is kind of cool.
Those are the only hits, I think, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, that song has always been a favorite of mine. It's just, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's you'll probably hear it on our local AM oldies.
I catch it on a local station that plays all the stuff. That's right.
That was the last time I heard it.
Yep.
Too. Yeah. Our oldie station is like those. When we were kids, they used to have oldies stations that used to play like swing music and Mantovani and his strings and Perry Como. There was,
right.
It used to be called pop music. And that was like for the old people. And now those stations no longer exist. There are oldie stations and they play really old music.
Yeah.
That was about the same age in relation to
that's right.
The old music when we were kids.
Got that right. So now that we're in the second half of the show, I want to put forth the second show topic, if you will.
I love when you produce. Yeah, this is great.
Since the first one got so much traction, maybe this one will. A good friend of ours got in touch with me and said, hey, you know, I fell into Chris's honor group where you were talking about washing things, cleaning parts in a washing machine.
Sure.
And he had said that he had cleaned some small parts. Well, let me see. I'll tell you exactly what he said because it was only this morning that this happened. He had...
But we still have not reached the pinnacle of using major appliances to clean the car parts as like you did... cleaning your basket spoke hubcaps in a dishwasher.
Well, he told me he cleaned 14-inch hubcaps. They fit on the bottom like plates. And and air cleaner lids, too. Air cleaner lids fit there. And the poverty caps fit in like bowls in the bowl hooks. And he said his windshield wiper washer fluid jug fit well, too. So I told him the story about my wire baskets off my mid-'80s Pontiac wagon. And I tell you, after that time we had a dishwasher that had a white plastic interior. It left a ring.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Oh, my.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure that will avoid a couple of warranties.
But I tell you what, though, the automotive and professional equivalent of that does exist. And Rolling Thunder Cycles has one. It's called a hot seat tank. And literally, it's a big square machine. You open the top lid, and it's got a rotating basket in it, and you put the engine parts or whatever in it, and close it,
I knew a guy on the avenue. His name was Hotsy.
Right,
guy.
Right.
You didn't want to borrow money from him.
Well, the fluid gets heated and then sprayed, and so it's basically a dishwasher with parts cleaning fluid in it.
Wow.
And the heat, especially when you take that stuff out. I've done intake manifolds over there, aluminum intakes, and all. Man, they come out beautiful. In fact, I brought in to the show many years ago something that I had. The bell housing that Brian, what's his name, from Motion, the four-speed guy, he gave me. And I had Gerard had cleaned it for me in the hot seat, and I brought it in to the show, and you took a picture, and we put it up on the old message board.
Right.
Aluminum comes out. It's beautiful in those hot seat machines. Yeah, Christian knows all about those, too. That's
Son of a gun. Yeah.
So if you've ever cleaned parts in a dishwasher or somewhere in the kitchen, let us know about it, because we'll add you to our list of going deviants.
And let us know if you were smart enough to throw the dishwasher away after you did it.
Oh, I know. I got nailed for that one. I did. I got hell?
Really?
I don't know. What do you mean? What happened? What happened to the dishwasher? I don't know. Let me take a look. Wow. Would you look at that? I don't know. Must have been something you cooked. I don't know, hon. Maybe it's maybe it was that stew. I don't know. It's.
I just want to know. Like, you're holding the hubcap in your hand and you see how dirty it is. What put the connection? What did you turn and look at the house with the hubcap in both hands and went, I'm gonna use the dishwasher to clean this? What sparked that major brainstorm?
That inclination probably came when I was outside and realized, like, how am I gonna clean these? This is too intricate to use a brush. I know, there's nobody home. I'll use the dishwasher on the pot scrubber cycle. Yeah, good idea. Yeah, well.
No one will know.
No one will know. No.
It won't affect any children.
It won't affect any children. No, nobody. No women and children will be hurt. Just a husband who's going to get his butt kicked by an irate housewife. Hey, you know.
All I had to do was tell my wife that story.
Uh-huh.
Just verbally, a verbal transfer of thoughts and ideas. That's all I had to do before I got the look.
Yeah, sure.
Well, you before know, I ended up directly in the doghouse right at that point, and I didn't even touch a hubcap.
Just because you knew me.
Because I know you.
I will tell you this. Now, going back to your original honor group statement, where you were saying, like, when you grew up, if your mom was... We didn't have a dishwasher growing up. We used our hands. That was a dishwasher. So, I think if we had, between my brother and I, we would have washed a lot of stuff in that dishwasher. And we would have put safety clean in there, too. Who knows? So thank God we didn't have a dishwasher growing up, because I would have been in big trouble.
Yeah, I'm sure. Hey, Mom, where are the cereal bowls? Oh, after you washed your parts, I washed them in the dishwasher. They melted.
Right. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, I would go as far as to wash my old rags in the washing machine.
Yeah.
And
that's a tough one.
Yeah, I even understand the ring.
Mm-hmm.
Because I remember my mom grabbing me by the upper lip and dragging me down the stairs and saying, take a look at that barrel of that washing machine. You better scrub that. And I was in there scrubbing it with a scrunge.
Right.
And getting all the, with a dishwashing detergent and a scrunge. I got my feet off the ground. I got my head in there, the top loader. And I'm scrubbing the bejesus out of that thing.
Well, we're scrunging on the phones, and we're going to say, hi, Callie, you're on with the MotorMouths.
Hey, it's Al Handy. How are you guys?
Oh, it's the other miscreant in the bunch who knows how to get in trouble and covers tracks. How you doing, Al?
I got a famous story. I was 18 years old, and I talked my dad into pulling the engine out of my Austin America. So we go out to the driveway, unbolt the motor mounts, transmission mounts, and we both physically lift the thing out of the car.
Right.
Put it on the cross member on for the hood.
Uh-huh.
I pick it up, carried into the house. My father is spreading newspaper down on the dining room table.
Uh-huh. Nice.
We put the engine and transmission on the dining room table and proceed to take it apart.
Oh,
with
my God.
Oil and everything dripping everywhere. Now, my mother and sister were out for the day shopping.
Yeah.
How convenient.
Oh, my God, did we catch...
You know, Al, I tell you, our good friend Christian from Long Island Racing was on the other line just now. He couldn't get through. I'm sure we'll get him after you. But he knows there's a picture that I sent out. I actually posted it on social media a while ago. It was my brother and I with a Harley Davidson 4-speed on a White Castle cafeteria tray on the kitchen table. And I think I'm puffing on a stogie. And he's like, only certain guys could grow up and do that and get away with it. And I was like, yeah, you're right.
Wow. I mean,
it was just. And we had new carpet, and there was greasy footprints across the carpet from the front door. Oh, did we get in trouble?
Right.
Al, and your dad was in on it.
Oh, yes, very much so, yeah.
Perfect.
Where's the responsible human being in this story?
they were out a long time.
Oh, I'm sure. Enough time for you guys to pull a motor and come up with that grand plan.
Yeah. It was hilarious.
That's the fascination to me. What was that, Al? Sorry.
Died. My mother was so would bring that up every once in a while. She'd be so ticked at me.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know what? It made us who we are today, for better or for worse.
Yeah, exactly.
Al, let me let you go. Let me get Christian in here. And we'll talk to you soon. Thank you.
Thanks, Al. Great story.
All right. So long. Yeah.
516-572-7440 is the phone.
We're going to hear from the master himself, who knows, who speaks Hotzi, who speaks Harley Davidson, who speaks miscreant things in the kitchen, who speaks all of that stuff.
I'm just thinking.
I knew one of these topics would get traction.
Brand new carpet. I'm thinking the finish on the dining room table after dropping a 4-cylinder. Now, mind you, 4-cylinder is a halfway decent engine. Two guys could pick it up fairly easily.
Oh, yeah.
But once you drop it on the table and tip it on its side, the finish to the table, even with the newspapers, the finish is gone. You just dented dented that table to the point where it'll never be repaired again.
Right.
In the dining room.
Sure. Oh, well, yeah, gosh. We did it in the kitchen, so why not the dining room? Yeah.
That to me is no. I wouldn't be here having this conversation if I were privy to either one of your stories. We would not be here. My mother would. It would be like. Literally, all I would see is white light.
I got to say, most of our deviant stuff took place in the basement. We did a lot of that stuff downstairs.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of the basement, here is our friendly dweller. All right, shoot.
Shoot what?
Christian.
Not just myself.
Shoot your load. Go
shoot
on.
Shoot myself.
Hey, it's a Sunday. What the heck?
What are we talking about today?
Go on.
My thing is buffering, so my feed is so messed up over here. I don't know who's calling, what's going on, so I'm sorry.
Okay, that's all right. No, that's cool.
I saw the dishwasher stories, and I'm like, oh, yeah.
I figured you. Well, I knew. Yeah, I knew you. You played with that, and of course, the hot seat is something you know that very well as well.
Which is to segue to the infamous puddles of gunk.
Puddles of gunk. Yeah,
I have all
remember
their
those
albums.
Days. Huh?
I have all their albums.
You do? Me too.
Right, the puddles of gunk.
In my liver, in my kidneys.
Yeah.
All around.
Oh, geez, yeah.
Remember those days?
Well, you know, Christian, you grew up much like I did in household-wise and getting away with stuff. And, of course, you know, I mean...
Toxic waste-wise.
You could have been the sweetest, most middle-of-the-road kid in the world. But, you know, growing up with the influences you had, you were destined from a long time ago to go some other path.
You were destined to a puddle of gunk.
Right.
I don't know what to say.
No, I know. You don't have to say anything. That's right.
Yeah, but it just those days. I have, you know, it's been a long time since I've played in that milky white, muddy niceness of the good old engine bright.
Right.
Yeah. And the garden hose. You know, this was like what. Before we only had head pressure from a hose and not a pressure washer. Yeah. That was like, what?
That's it, right. That's all we had.
You had your thumb over it.
Biodegradable?
Yeah, no.
Now.
No.
But we used to have the house that we had in Elmont years ago, my father and everybody, you know, there was like three houses on the property and there was no grass.
It wouldn't grow.
Everywhere you...
You park right. your Harley, it leaked or whatever. But, you know, we used to wash the bikes. We used to gunk small block Chevys down and stuff, swapping motors. And they always had those, like, white puddles in the yard. Yeah. But we had a pet duck.
Ah.
And the duck would come over and drink out of the puddle.
Oh, no.
And we had... We had no control over it, but that duck was fine.
You know, to add to that, in our yard, before we were old enough to even drive, we had the mini bike circuit. You'd come up the driveway, you know, we had a long driveway, and then yep. onto the lawn, around the backyard, and around the whole, the long side of the house, around the front lawn, back to the driveway. And that was our, and that oval was just worn out.
Until you kick the rod out of the cone, so that was over.
And then you go, you know, some other neighbor's garage. Everybody had side shaft lawnmowers. You jack another one off, and there you go. You throw it back on. Go down to Curtis Welding in Limbrook and weld on the clutch, and you'd have it all set. Be back.
But Christian, so I know exactly times, what you're talking about.
Kicking a rod out on a Tecumseh at 30 miles an hour, getting covered in hot oil. I don't know.
Yeah.
All you've been the there, done that, right?
All the above.
We had a lawn, a patch of grass next to the driveway, and about a foot of it, you would never see a blade of grass because, like you said, it was either a mixture of coolant or the white gump, the white engine bright water or whatever.
Yeah. Well, you know what else?
Yeah, nothing grew
well,
there.
You know what else did a great job on the lawn was 90 weight. Of course, when you do trannies, you have four-speed trannies and rear ends. Yeah, the 90 weight oil, it just stayed there. It like the La Brea tar pits. It's like, don't step over there.
My friend's father, he worked for Grumman, you know, lived over in Wheatley Heights, and he had like one of those red, remember the infamous basket weave fences?
Oh, yeah.
And it was always like that red, matched the furniture in the yard.
Uh-huh.
He was a smart guy. I learned a lot from him, but I tell you, he used to do an oil change, and then he'd go over, and he would pour all the oil down every fence post.
Oh, wow.
And you never had to use a weed whacker, because there was always that black ring around the fence post. Nothing would grow.
Yep.
And his reasoning was to preserve the fence posts. Those fence posts are probably still there. You know what? I got to go drive over there and see if that stupid fence is still up, and you never know.
There you go, right? You never know.
You know? All the time. I probably shouldn't be talking about such things now.
Well, listen, you're in this juncture right now. You're a civilian. We're on the air here. We're on record with the FCC, and we're talking about it, so don't worry about it.
And no one's listening but the three of us, so don't worry about it.
I just don't realize when I'm on with you guys. I feel like I'm just on the, you know, what's the air anymore?
That's a great promo clip right there.
Yeah.
You're right.
Nobody's listening. That's what's always stuck in my head anyway with you guys. Great.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. Hey. You know.
But in retrospect here of all this, now that we're into the new age, I haven't really spoken to you about it because I figured I'd give you some time, see how things were going. So how's it been with your ultrasonic?
I haven't done a lot of jobs with it. I'm waiting to do more. Now, of course, when I had the thing, I did do a few jobs in it. The problem is I bought that 3-liter one. It takes a ton of water, man.
Okay.
When you're talking about an ultrasonic, just real fast, you're talking about taking parts, dirty parts, and putting them in like a tub and using sound waves to clean it. Am I correct?
Yes.
Okay, good. Yes. Yeah.
All right.
And what I'm doing is I'm using the method from the fellow I watch on YouTube. He's a Canadian, does small engine repair. And what he does, he puts the dirty parts in a secondary container with the cleaning fluid, seals it, and drops that in the water so that the actual ultrasonic cleaner doesn't get gunky in the black ring. That's secondary containers do. So, yeah, I've had great luck. And, in fact, now I just realize I have a couple small things I want to do, and I'm thinking, damn, I got to do a lot just to do some small work. But that's the problem when you buy too big of a machine. But I actually have a job coming in. It's a guy's got a 99 Honda CB900, and he wants the carbs done.
So I was going
to ask you, I want to see if I can just do them as a rack and not break the carburetors apart.
That's the whole purpose of it. You don't have to break the rack down.
That's what I'm going
to
do, right. That's how I'm going to do it.
Yep. Ultrasonics is so good, you could actually even leave the floats in and everything. I mean, obviously on a rack of carbs like those are probably like the McConies. They have the float needle seats that you probably should pull out, but, you know, sometimes, you know how you pull those out, the O-rings are bad.
Right.
So, obviously, it's all on ultrasonic at first, while it's still hot, you'll be able to get those seats out a lot easier because they usually have that little screw off to the side to hold them in. That's offset.
Right, right.
And then once the carbs have the heat into it and they get somewhat clean, you'll find that, you know, you can still pull those out and then the screens will still be kind of funky, but it helps, you know, loosen them up and stuff like that.
Right, right.
But, you know, as you use those, you find the tricks, you find what works, you figure it out. You know, it takes time to get used to it. It's a whole new thing, and it's just a lot safer for you.
Oh, sure.
Not
sure.
That it really matters for us, I don't
think.
No,
I know.
Anyway.
We're done. Yeah. You kidding me?
We're done.
Do the autopsy now. You get the same results as in another 20, 30 years. It doesn't matter.
Exactly.
Well, I said, you know, yeah. I don't know. Gunk, Barry Mini.
Ray's glow just changes color. That's,
right.
That's it.
Yeah.
It's just a... oh, boy. Fence post. Okay.
Yeah. Fence post. Phenolic.
Phenolic.
All right.
Yeah, but anyway, I'll let you guys go.
All right.
Got half the wall ripped out on the house, as usual, working on the house, and not making any of the car shows, as usual.
Yeah.
Hey, my brother. I'm doing the same thing.
You got to do it.
Yeah. Bathrooms and... things and all that good stuff. So,
All right, thanks for the call, Christian.
You and I are going to start. Christian and I are going to start like a home improvement radio show.
There you go.
Yeah, I know. It's like, what year is your Cape Cod? You know,
right?
Mine's a 51.
Oh, mine's a 53.
You know? Yeah, mine's a 51.
You know, the most amusing thing is like when they stuff the newspaper around the original windows. It's I got some great cartoons.
Yeah.
I got some good ones.
Snuffy Smith.
And you know, back then they used, you know, a lot of lead in the ink, so that the comics hold up.
Smokey Stover.
Yes.
I have it.
Yep.
I took all the newspaper in this house and I flattened them out. They're down in my basement, flattened out right now. They're in perfect condition.
Got to frame them, dude.
Here we are on the cartoon show.
Yeah. Yep. Flatten them out.
Good
put
stuff.
Them in frame.
Smokey Stover. Holy cow.
That's awesome.
All right.
I wasn't even around in 51. Jesus. Okay, anyway.
All right, Christian.
Later.
Thanks, brother. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Oh, yeah. The stuff you remember.
Yeah, exactly. That's incredible. But it's true. It's that's what stops, I'd say, the majority of us from... going back to our cars again, is that eventually you're going to end up with a home improvement or 9 or 12.
Well, of course.
Yeah, it's always the case.
I have some power washing in my near future because I was waiting for the weather to get a little warmer, you know, and I got to do the deck and I got to do all the driveway. But I bought a nice, an attachment. It's a round disc that has like a spinning wand in it. So now you can do like at least a foot wide swatch at a time. You're not using just the small power washer edge.
Yeah, nice. And I need something like that for a fence.
I bought it at, I guess you can use it on a fence. I bought it at Lowe's. Yeah, they had one. So
very cool.
Yeah,
and you could do like a foot wide pass.
Yeah, because it's round, you know, and it has wheels so you can maneuver it and turn it. But I guess the thing has the diameter of it is maybe a little more than a foot. It could be, I don't know, 13, 14 inches, but say a foot. Mm-hmm. It is a little wider than a foot, but, you know, and you're going to overlap anyway. So what I want to do is, you know, my FJ, again, sitting under the tree is disgusting with all the tree sap and all the stuff. I want to get an electric, because the power washer I have is a big Honda 8.5 horsepower or 10 horsepower. It's a big mama Luke. And I want to get a electric power washer that I can use just for quick things like that, like if I want to clean the truck with it. But I don't know which one to get, and I'm going to probably... I'll talk to Paul. He knows all about that stuff.
Don't order one on Amazon.
No?
No.
Okay.
I ordered one, and it lasted one driveway.
Wow.
Before it quit. It is sitting in the garage collecting dust.
Well,
one day when I get a chance, I'm going to take it apart. But
well, then again, if you purchase it through Amazon, they kind of guarantee the purchase, and you can return.
Well, not after I've used it.
Well, how else would you know if it was bad? You don't know if it's bad sitting in a box.
I used it now. I mean, I covered a big driveway with it.
Uh-huh.
And it quit.
You could try. So, yeah, now it's probably too, you know.
Yeah, now I think I bought it a year ago. So.
Right, right. Yeah.
And of course, it sat in a box for 6 months.
Right.
So, you know, I'm very irresponsible when it comes down to it. I don't just buy something and then rip it out of the box the second it shows up and plug it in and start using it.
No, because I do the same thing because you don't always need it. You get something because you know you're going to use it at some point, and this way you have it available. So, yeah, that happens to all of us.
But definitely do your research on anything like that. Don't just go out and buy it. I didn't even buy the cheapest one. Usually that's what my wife is always
like the K Archer. So, you know, that's,
she's always accusing me of that.
Right.
You buy the cheap ones. No, I didn't. I didn't buy the cheap one.
Well, she sees your cars and your tools, and she knows, you know, she's getting a profile on you. So she's saying, hey, you probably Transcend. But no, you know, maybe you just got the lemon. I don't know.
Yeah, I could have. It's I don't even remember the name of it. It was an off-brand, and it was green.
That's speaking of lemon, when I mentioned air fresheners before, Chassis John did tell me that he likes the lemon-scented air fresheners. I've never had one of those. You know, I like the pine, the old-fashioned pine tree. That takes me back to the 70s. Because those are the only ones you could ever get. And now my daughter loves black ice. Whatever. You know, it's like, no.
You know which one I don't like? The banana.
Okay.
You ever smell the banana?
No, I haven't.
I don't get that.
I'll tell you this. The pine, the only place I can get the real good scented ones now are down south. Where I went to Tennessee or I went to North Carolina, I stocked up on them.
Well, that's where they grow them.
It's a different scent than we have here. So I tell you what, we're going to get the heck out of here so Kim can come in and do Thunder Road, Best of Springsteen and the Band, and you'll be in for a rousing 2 hours of radio and music because she's always got some good stuff planned. We'll be back next week, Chris. I don't know if we'll have a guest or not. If not, we'll talk about more crazy stuff. So what do we always say? What do you say that John says that we always like to say?
Don't follow us home and get rid of that Playboy Bunny air freshener. For crying out loud, just get rid of it.
And bring me ring dings. All right. For Chris Switzer, Ray Guarino, 90.3 WHPC, we're out. See ya.
See ya, bye. All right.